to know. So let's take a breath now and relax now. I want you to feel all the love that's going on around this city right now. I want you to feel all the specialness and the love that's going on right now. It's oozing. It's oozing. And behind it is the desire for love. Behind all the specialness is the desire for love. So if you don't mind, those who don't mind just getting deep into just feeling for a second with you, or like close your eyes and focus in on yourself. You are the one sent of the Creator, created before all things. You are only love. You are only love. Share your love, share your life. Share your heart. Share your time. Share your love. Share your mind. You are not your mind. You are not your body. You are not your personality. You are not your history. You are not your mind. You are not your body. You are not your personality. You are not your history. You do not belong to the world. You don't belong to the world. You are that vibration, that note of love. You are the Christ consciousness, the love consciousness. And that's where you live. You live in the love consciousness. You love equally. You love without reservation. You love without possessiveness. You love equally. You love without reservation. You love without possessiveness. You love only to extend the presence of God, which is love. You love only to extend the presence of God, which is love, that another might touch, that another might touch that place within them and be set free. You love only to extend the presence of God, that another might touch that place within them and be set free. I love only to extend the presence of love, that another might touch that place within them and be set free. Thank you. Welcome to the Way of Mastery. Sometimes there's a part of me that's always kind of a little nervous about getting into this because what it says is so radically different from what I usually hear. And like the section that I'm going to be doing tonight is called Be the Presence of the Love that God Is, which is on page 311, lesson 26, Allowing Purification. Those of you online, we're going to be in the Way of Knowing, in the Way of Mastery, lesson 26, Allowing Purification, on page 311, in the Way of Knowing. So what we want to do is get in the right frame of mind for hearing it. And do you know that the right frame of mind for hearing this is to remember you don't need to believe it, the ideas. You don't need to accept the ideas. You don't need to welcome the ideas. Some of these ideas are going to be very startling. And some of these ideas are going to be hard to believe. You're not being asked to be judges or to analyze it at all. It's the use of it that will show you that it's true. Everybody clear? Everybody got it? You don't have to believe me. You don't have to accept nothing I'm saying. Welcome it. None of it. Okay. Then I can go ahead and dive in. This section is called Be the Presence of the Love that God Is. And it says, listen very carefully. So I'm going to go through a little of it, and then we'll, you know, we'll talk about it, and then I'll go through some more, and we'll talk about it. So it says, listen very carefully indeed. Listen very, very carefully. It's got a big exclamation mark after it. To listen very carefully. Indeed, listen very, very carefully. If you want to know the love of God, if you want to know the love of the Creator, this is what you do. You must be that love. If you want to know the love of the universe, you must be it. If I want to know your love, I must be loving. You cannot know about love. You cannot know about love. You must literally be the presence of that love. Nobody can tell you about love. You can't know about love. You have to be the presence of the love. Only then can you know God or the Creator. If I want to know your love, I must be love. If you want to know anybody else's love, you must be love. If you want to have love, you must be love. To anybody that don't understand what I just said, this is the essence of the way of knowing. The essence of the way of knowing is that the way you know something, the way you truly know something, is to be it. Knowing by being that which you have knowledge or direct experience of, and by choosing to be only that which you have knowledge or direct experience of. That's why knowledge is a mystical experience. When you study books like The Way of Mastery, you're actually studying mysticism. You are studying and having a mysterious experience, a mystical experience. That's why true knowing is immediate. True love is immediate. If I truly love you, it doesn't take months, weeks, minutes, certain number of dates, or hours. True knowing has an immediacy about it. Have you ever met someone and you just wanted to get as close as possible to get to know them immediately? Mm-hmm. You were praying that they would come your way. Mm-hmm. It is not mediated through a theology. What I'm talking about has nothing to do with religion. It has nothing to do with philosophy. It doesn't have anything to do with any words. So what I'm talking about doesn't have anything to do with religion, doesn't have anything to do with philosophy, doesn't have anything to do with words. Words are just symbols of symbols. Words are just symbols of symbols. Actually, words are symbols of ideas. So ideas are a step still away from reality. One who knows love in every cell of their body. When you know love, you will know it in every cell of your body. That's when you know you're in the presence of love. It'll be immediate. You'll feel it in every cell of your body, and you'll be it yourself. It's so easy for me to tell now when somebody doesn't love me. You're trying to put a guilt trip on me. You don't love me. You're trying to limit me. You don't love me. So does that make me mad at you? Mm-hmm. No. 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 I said, does it make me mad at you? It might make you mad at me, but don't make me mad at you. Why? Because I'm not going to get emotionally invested enough to get mad at you. Because I know you don't love me. So I don't have agreements against you. But you didn't hurt me. You didn't hurt me because I was aware that you didn't know how to love. So I already know from the very beginning what we're going to go through. We're going to go through periods where we really can to each other and caring, and go through periods where we are separate and afraid and upset. I know that already because you don't love me. Because you want to limit me in some way, or I want to limit you. Did you know that those you limit, you hate? You certainly wouldn't try to limit someone you love, would you? Don't forget now. You need not believe these ideas. You need not accept these ideas. You don't have to like them. Some of it's going to startle you. Some of it's going to be hard to believe. Is that making more sense now? Okay. Then it tells us next, say, the way of knowing culminates with your perfect resolve to be the presence of the love that God is. At the point that a person has finally achieved knowledge, all they will want is to be the presence of God or love all the time. So when you say, what is it you want to achieve? They'll go, I want to be the presence of real love all the time. Until that's the answer I get in one way or another, then I also know I'm not talking to a person who knows. So I still can't get mad. So I'm trying to have a relationship with a person that doesn't love me and doesn't know anything. And I wonder why we have challenges. If they want to limit me, I know they don't love me. If they know, they're going to say, I want to be the presence of love in your life. I want to be a living example of love in your life. I wonder how many people at their Valentine's celebration are saying this to each other. Well, actually, many of them are, I would assume, and many of them are clarifying the level of limitations they want to put on each other. I'm trying to make that clearer. This is so deep. Now, if you would truly know love, the first thing you got to do is look at the things you fear. What? If you really want to know love, you have to be willing to look at what you're afraid of. Discover what you are afraid of. Dig everything that you are afraid of up and out of yourself. If you want to know what love is, look at what you're afraid of. Discover what you are afraid of. Dig it up and out of yourself. Rest assured, anytime you must look at another person and analyze them, there is something you are afraid of. So you are afraid of the people that you analyze.
Can you give me another word for analyze?
Judge. Trying to break them down. Here's a great phrase. You're trying to figure them out. So whoever you're trying to figure out, you're afraid of. There's something you fear. Anything that pushes your buttons lets you know there's still something requiring your love. So whenever somebody pushes your button, you know there's something inside of you that still requires your love. If I push your buttons, there's something in you that requires your love. Not something necessarily in me that requires your love because I push your button. So you think it's all about trying to learn to love me even though I push your button? You ever done that? Even though this person really, really upsets you, you're trying to love them? It says, no. Your button being pushed means there's something in you that hasn't been accepted. There's something in you that needs to be loved. They're just letting you know it's there. That's why they're pissing you off. So be grateful for the people that upset you. They are letting you know where you need to love yourself more. And there may be a lot of people in your life letting you know that. You might be a crowd of people who upset you and push your buttons, which means you're trying to move faster than usual. You're giving yourself, oh, I need to heal myself about that. Oh, I need to love 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 myself about that because I'm getting upset. My buttons are being pushed by you. And what button was pushed? Oh, that one, that one, that one, that one. The button of, I think you're selfish. I got some selfishness. I think you're cruel. I got some cruelty in me. I think you're not considerate enough. I need to be considerate for myself. You don't treat me like I'm significant. Oh, I don't treat myself like I'm significant enough. Oh, you don't give. Oh, okay, I don't give to me enough.
You're lazy.
You're lazy. I'm pretty lazy. I need to love and accept. You see, everybody that's pushing your buttons are letting you know what you need to love in yourself. And then when you're around people who don't push your buttons, then you know you're happy. You know you're happy. Not they're happy. You know you're happy. All right. Let's stop right there. Any questions? Any comments? You don't have to agree with me. I don't have to agree with you. It's okay. Did anybody hear anything that was startling? What did you hear that was startling, Chris?
So it's interesting because about the pushing your buttons. I had a situation yesterday where I was in a situation with someone where...
Would you speak louder so our brothers and sisters online can hear you?
I was in a situation yesterday where I felt myself wanting to take something from someone, where I wanted to get something from someone. So in my mind, I thought, well, I'm going to give something. I'm going to give encouragement. And I gave this person encouragement, and for lack of a better word, she went off on me.
So just a certain amount of heat.
So in my mind, I thought, for lack of a better word, she went off on me.
Okay.
And so, just what you were talking about, the triggers, it just brought that up because, like, I'm still confused about, like, you know, like, I thought that I had did everything right. And, even as this was going on and it continued, I knew that, you know, I didn't do anything wrong and that, like, I was only trying to be loving, but yet I still felt, like, my energy going down and me being pulled down.
I think
and I was just confused. Why?
Yeah. And so what conclusion have you come to?
Well, it was her call for love.
Right.
And my call for love, too.
Right. Stop right there.
Beautiful.
Don't go a step further. Don't try to analyze that. Don't try to figure that out. That's what it is. Your call for love met her call for love. You realized that there was something in you requiring love because your buttons had been pushed. You realize that there was something in her requiring love because her buttons have been pushed. So both of you were calling for love. You were both calling for God. You were both calling for the truth, which is to remember that neither one of you did anything to each other. She just didn't act out your script for how she should have responded. And you didn't act out her script about how you should have responded. She didn't act out your script about how, in other words, you were given the love, and it looked like you didn't get the response that you wanted.
Right.
Right? So you know you weren't giving her love. Mm. Well, love would have been unoffended by her response.
Right.
So she showed you that you need to work on being the presence of love, getting the blocks out more. She needs to work on getting the presence of love and her awareness, because her own fear made her react to your overture with fear, right? So you dug up some fear that needed to be looked at, just like I just said.
Yeah.
And because of that, now you know more about what love is, don't you?
Well, you do.
You know that had it really been love, then you would have been okay no matter how she responded.
Right, right.
So it wasn't love you were offering her.
Okay.
Because it was conditional on how she responded to you. It was specialness you offered her. Or the desire to get it. So that's why I said it. There's a lot of that going on right now, all over the city.
Right.
Yeah, right now. Right now. There are a lot of people promising things because they want to get something. Mm-hmm. There are two kinds of... There are love collectors and there are love gatherers. Gatherers don't try to collect each other. They just share. Mm-hmm. Collectors want the love just for themselves, and then they want to hang it in a museum for everybody to see. So we build museums to love. We are collectors. So we are now wanting to go to be love gatherers. Had I really wanted to give out of my heart, I wouldn't have gotten upset about the person's response, even if their response was anger and upset and misperception.
So, but I'm discouraged about that because I knew that, like, at first I wanted to get something from her. So then, like, the thought that I got in my head was, well, that I'm going to try to give something instead of trying to get something.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I thought I was making progress.
And she showed you that you are making progress because you at least you had the desire to give instead of getting, even though you still wanted to get. But at least you wanted to give.
And you did something different.
You know, you had the attitude that you wanted to give, but your reaction let you know that you really still wanted to get.
It's called barter.
Yeah, because think of it. If I'm giving to you and I'm giving to you freely, then the giving is the receiving. That I've gotten my fulfillment just from giving. Right?
Right.
So if I'm trying to get, then I feel like something is missing from my giving. So your feelings let you know that even though your purpose might have been love, you still were going about it the way you learned in the past. That's all. You know, your motive was good, you just still went about it the way all of us have learned to do it. Some form of bargain, some form of getting, some form of script.
And that's where I guess I need to see the progress, though, because like my mind automatically wants to go to like the all or nothing.
Okay, if you want to see the progress, I would invite you to listen to what I just said, which is the fact that you wanted to be more loving, even though you went about it in a way that was the old way, so it didn't work, the fact that you even wanted to be loving is progress. So let yourself have that. Don't be so determined to not feel good about yourself that you still try to think of more ways you disappointed you. I ain't gonna support it.
Thank you.
So you can sit up there and keep on going other ways that you did it wrong, long as you want to. I'm not going to support you in that.
Thank you.
Okay? You progressed.
Thank you.
And as you said many times, willingness is not mastery.
Willingness is not mastery. Just because I'm willing to love you don't mean I've mastered it. It just means I have some willingness, some potential to achieve. Right? Yeah.
Good experiment in the lab.
Yeah, and keep on experimenting, you know.
Yeah.
Because if you get some buttons pushed, you know it requires love in yourself. Anybody else have anything they want to share? Yes. Yes, young man.
The whole thing of limiting, wanting to limit somebody that you hate them, and I thought that was a rather poignant word.
I'm trying to be gentle. It's Valentine's Day. I would have really been rough in what I said. I'm being nice.
But, when it came to mind, I was like, well, how do you don't give a shit about them? Maybe you're just apathetic. But I guess if you're apathetic, then you wouldn't try to limit them.
Thank you. Thank you. You see, I'm only trying, I'll tell you why I want to limit you. I want to limit you to my purposes and my fantasies. Mm-hmm. That's why. Mm-hmm. That's what I mean. I want to limit you. I want to join with my fantasies in uninterrupted bliss, damn it. Don't you dare bring you into this relationship. And I refuse personally to enter relationships that I can't enter. And I've had people say they wanted to love me, but they just keep wanting to leave me out. Because I tell them what I want, where I'm coming from, how I express myself, what my values are, and what's important to me, and they go, well, I don't like that. But this is me. You're not going to limit me. I'm going to be free. And you're going to be free. That's the way I roll. Mm-hmm. So this is me. Mm-hmm. This is not your fantasy. Mm-hmm. This is me. And then they tell you, well, if you just change all those qualities, then I'll be in a relationship with you. So that's a relationship that I can't enter. And it's supposed to be my relationship with you. And you're saying, leave me out. It's like saying to me, Earl, you are a tiger. And I could really love you if you could just get rid of those stripes. So it's real simple to tell, for me to tell now, if I'm in the presence of somebody that loves me. They accept me as I am. And if they don't, I go, oh, don't get deep into this relationship, buddy. This person doesn't love you. They may want to. And I'm glad. I'm grateful. Just like what Chris just said. He was attempting. Even though he didn't do it perfect, he was attempting. So when people tell me they love me, I'm grateful. But I also know if they believe what the world teaches, they're going to go about it in a way that could be painful for me if I go along with it. Because they're going to try to limit me some kind of way. And they're going to try to make me feel guilty for not doing what they want me to do. Because they think love is sacrifice. And so they expected me to sacrifice myself for them. And that makes me unselfish. So I run that in my mind at the very beginning. And then I say, overlook the butt, overlook the butt. The butt is calling, no.
Yes, I just do the opposite. I go, look at the butt, okay, I'm not right with that.
Yeah. And what? How do you end it? Look at the butt, what?
Well, see, that way I put up with a lot of crap from you.
Oh, that allows you to maintain your commitment. That's great.
You can't abuse the hell out of me.
Okay, no matter what's going on between us, because of your butt, I will stay. That's awesome. That explains why people spend so much time at the gym. Yeah.
I really like, Raj, the specific instruction that this book gives us, and that we are being asked to, if we really want to truly know love, then we need to look upon all of the things that we fear and discover them and dig them up out of ourselves. I really
very
like
specific
that.
Instructions.
Very, I know.
There's nothing abstract about this teaching.
Right.
That's why when I, at the end of it, when I find myself asking, and what should I do?
Right.
I realized I haven't paid any attention to what I was being told because I was being told what to do. If I want to know the love of God, be the love of God. If you want to let go of your, if you want to experience love, be willing to look at your fear. Mm-hmm. If someone pushes your button, tell yourself there's something inside of me that needs to be loved right now. Just very specific instructions telling us what to do. And it goes on to say, The way of knowing beloved friends can culminate only in the transformation of your mind to such a level of completion that you could sit in your chair and say, there is only God. There has never been a separate me. There never could have been a separate me. This is only. There is only this moment. There is only this moment in which love can dance. There is only this moment in which love can be celebrated. If we're going to celebrate love, we can only do it now. If we're going to extend love, we can only do it now. So, Father, Mother, God, Creator, what can we create this day that offers to the world the grace of the good, the holy, and the beautiful? So, universe, what can we create this day that just offers to the world what's good and what's innocent and what's beautiful? Universe, what can we create this day that offers to the world the grace of the good, the innocent, and the beautiful? In other words, let me break it down even more. What can I create with you all right now that only offers you something that's good and innocent and beautiful? God, what can I offer the people that's sitting in front of me right now that will give them what's good and what's innocent and what's beautiful? God, what can I offer to the people that are sitting in front of me and watching me right now that offers them the good, the innocent, and the beautiful? A very direct instruction to me. this is what you would do if you want to. What's the name of the section?
If you want to be the presence of the love that God is.
If you want to be the presence of the love that God is, then you should say when you're around people, what can I create that offers them the opportunity to experience something innocent and beautiful and good? Instruction. I once described the highest state of consciousness, the highest state of purification, as a state in which the child has awakened. So the highest level of consciousness is a state when you and I, as children, have awakened and looks around them and sees no limits, which is infinity. You're not awake until you look around yourself and see no limits. You can't even see where you begin and where somebody else ends. Wow. Have you ever experienced a joining with somebody that was so powerful that you couldn't tell where you began and they began, and you felt completely merged and completely joined? Well, I hope you do one day. And it says, for such is their union, such is their marriage, such is their dance, the unformed and the formed, the source and the created, the creator and the creating, that's the alchemical marriage that one cannot look and see where your soul ends and where God begins. Yet the awakened mind knows that it is still the created. And so it surrenders in perfect joy. It's an awakened mind surrenders every moment in perfect joy. And it says this, Creator, love, what would you have me do? Love, what do you want me to do? What is your will for me? God, what do you want me to do? What is your will for me? That's what a mind that's awake says. And it also says something very interesting. It says the awake mind knows that it is still the created. So an awakened mind would be a mind that knows. An awakened mind would be a mind that knows it didn't create itself. So a mind that's awake is a mind that knows, a person that's awake is a person that knows they didn't create themselves. Mm-hmm. The Course in Miracles in the Way of Mastery says, we live and act as if we created ourselves. That we literally created ourselves. He says, not only do we act like we created ourselves, we also act like the direction of our creation is up to us. That creation is going to be whatever you decide it is. That the truth is going to be whatever you decide it is. And you know that's true because, remember, have you ever noticed that you, one statement you hear a lot is people say, I have my truth and you have your truth. I have my truth and you have your truth. The direction of creation is up to me. What is true and real is up to me. It's what I say. It's true and real. So it says we make two mistakes. First, we think we created ourselves, and then we think we can change reality into whatever we want it to be because we want it to be that way. And if it's not really that way, we'll make it seem like it's that way, even if it's not. Then hurt ourselves because we're deceiving ourselves about what's really happening.
Sure.
And that's why you hurt yourself. He says we'll want something so bad, we'll make it up in our mind like it's that way. And then deal with it like it's that way. But since it's not really that way, it always fails us. He says, and then you end up crying. Because you deceived yourself. Thank you very much.
Well, one thing I hear a lot in the communities that I go around is that I'm manifesting. I need to manifest such and such. And I think that's the same thing as, you know,
well, the ability to manifest is real. Mm-hmm. What you use that ability to manifest is either something real or something unreal. I'm a manifest, but there's only two things I can allow to be manifested through me, and that's love or fear. So people think they're choosing between things, but they're really choosing between whether you're going to scare the hell out of yourself through this or whether or not you're going to really enjoy yourself and love it. Those are the only two choices you're really making from moment to moment. Is this going to be something that I give myself peace through, or is this going to be something else that I'm upset about? And you know it's not the thing that's causing it, because somebody else can be very happy about the thing you're unhappy about. So you know that thing is neutral. You know, some people break up with another person, they think it's the best thing that ever happened to them. Somebody else break up and they're devastated. It's still a breakup. But one person saw it in a way that freed them, especially since it's broken up. And then the other person saw it in a way that caused them a lot of pain. But the event was neutral. It didn't have any meaning until you gave it meaning. It's hard for me to accept sometimes that I don't mean anything to some people. I don't want to think anybody that's ever been in a relationship with me has forgotten me. And it's like they never were with me. But it's got to be true, because I've done that with people that I'm no longer with. Mm-hmm. I don't wake up in the morning going, oh, let me think of the girlfriend I had in the seventh grade. So I have to accept that my meaning to people was a gift that they gave me for as long as they wanted to. And when they no longer wanted to give me meaning, they took it back. It's a gift. But it's more than a gift, it's a bargain.
And it's not who you are.
They absolutely, we don't know who we are, because he's already said, if you knew who you were and they knew who they were, you all would just be the presence of love in each other's life, and it wouldn't be any dissatisfaction with each other at all. The dissatisfaction is because you don't know who you are and you don't know who they are. You see, you're here to be my fantasy. So if you don't act out my fantasy, I'm disappointed. That's why I'm disappointed. If I didn't have a fantasy for you to act out, you couldn't disappoint me. So it never was about you. It was about my fantasy. That's why I'm disappointed. You are love. You are an unlimited child of God. You are spirit. You are perfect and whole. Everything else I see in you is my fantasy. It's what I've made up about you. And since I don't see you with that kind of love, I know that I don't really see any of you yet. Well, you'd be a hell of a lot happier to see me, and I'd be a hell of a lot happier to see you. When you know the truth, nobody can hide from you. When you know the truth, there are no secrets. All you have to do is open your eyes and look. And you'll see who loves you, who doesn't love you, who recognizes the truth, who doesn't recognize, who's lying, and who's telling the truth. The Course in Miracles said at the beginning of it, the freak man said, there are no private thoughts. I said, what? He said, there are no private thoughts. You just think thoughts are private because you can't see yet. And I just wonder, what you talking about? But then I studied long enough, and it taught me the difference between love and fear. Notice how I was saying, an awakened mind knows blah, 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 blah. An awakened mind does blah, 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 blah. But when you hear that and you learn it, then when people are talking to you, you can discern, based on what you've learned, whether or not you're talking to an awakened mind or a mind that's asleep. Not guilty. Not bad. Mm-hmm. Not sinful. Just sleep. Unaware. Then you have to ask yourself, do I want to experience the experiences that you go through when you're with an unaware mind? Because it's going to be pain and fear and guilt and anger broken in two by periods in which they seem to be gone. In other words, there'll be some periods that seem to be great. Woo. So all you have to do is listen, right? Because if you listen, everybody will tell you everything you need to know. And they'll also tell you the curriculum that they set up for themselves for their happiness. And they'll tell you the role that they've decided you should play, whether you like it or not. How do you know that? Because they'll tell you what they think they want. And when someone is telling you sincerely what they think they want, they're telling you everything you need to know about them. If I say, what do you want? What's the most important thing to you? And a person says to me, the most important thing to me is money. Or the most important thing to me is fame. Or the most important thing to me is, you know, the most important thing should be ultimately, if they're awake, to be the presence of God, the presence of the love of God, to be the presence of love. If I'm awake, I want to be love, because that's what I am. Love. How many people have you met that when you asked them what they wanted, has ever said to you, I want to be the presence of love? That's awesome. But notice there wasn't a whole lot of people raised their hands. That's not a put down. It's just spirit trying to let us know how you can tell when you're in the presence of someone that's awake in that moment. They might go back to sleep. But in that moment, whoever told you that, at least they were, even if it looked like they were faking it, they still were telling you the truth. So that's the thing about it. Even if a person isn't sincere when they tell you the truth, this still doesn't stop the truth from being true. Your sincerity doesn't have anything to do with the truth of what you're saying to me if it's really the truth. You could insincerely say to me, Earl, all that you give, you're giving to yourself. And whether you believe that or not, that's the truth. You could insincerely say to me, Earl, you give everything you see all the meaning that it has for you. You could say that to me and don't believe it. But it's still true. It is true. I am giving everything I see. So it doesn't matter if the other person means what they say. If you recognize the truth, you know that what they're saying is true or not. And it could be true and helpful to you even if they are not sincere. Nothing real depends on anybody else's cooperation for you to experience it. Anything that's real is in you and is what you are right now. So it's nothing you need to get from anybody else. I don't need you to agree with me for what could be coming through me could be the truth. Does everybody see that? Mm-hmm. Your agreeing with me has nothing to do with whether or not what I'm saying is the truth. Mm-hmm. If it's the truth. So did you see how empowering that is? How if you live your life from your heart, following your guidance and what felt authentic to you, regardless of what anybody else was doing, you would be constantly awakening and you wouldn't need anybody else to say, Earl, you know what? I think that what you said tonight is true. And if I say what you said tonight was true, then it's true. Or if I disagree with what you say, then somehow or another that means something. It doesn't mean anything unless I give it meaning to me. Your opinion doesn't mean anything to me unless I give it meaning to me. What I'm saying to you, it doesn't mean anything to you unless you give it meaning to you. And I know that as I teach. I have no power over that. But I also can't let that affect my acceptance of the truth for me. That's all that matters. Not whether you agree for me, but if I agree with me. Does that mean I'm not open to listening to other people's opinions and thoughts and ideas? Not at all. It's highly entertaining. People entertain me all the time with their ideas. I like to hear people's ideas. There are even some ideas that they say that I want to adopt as my own and use them. So this is like you all are going through a grocery store, and I know you don't pick up everything in the grocery store. You just pick up what you want to buy. That's what you're doing tonight. That's what you're doing tonight. You're buying what you want to buy out of what I'm saying. But the person that owns the grocery store is glad no matter what you buy. So I'm happy no matter what you buy. Because all I'm saying is, you are the presence of love. You are the presence of God. You deserve to have people when they're around you, the love they feel for you goes through every cell of their body. And they would never want to limit you, and they would always want your safety and for you to have what's beautiful and good in your life. And if you think a person that's telling you that is someone that's lying to you, let's say I'm saying this and I have no sincerity whatsoever, I'm the biggest con artist that ever sit in front of you, that doesn't make anything I've said a lie. You are deserving of love. You are deserving of people who are around you. They feel love for you in every cell of your body. It doesn't matter if I mean it or not, because it's the truth. So if it's the truth, you don't have to believe it for it to be true. If it's the truth, you don't have to believe it. What could be easier than that? You don't believe I love you. Doesn't have to have anything to do with me treating you beautifully. Big deal. You don't believe it. You think that's why I'm going to be cruel to you now? Because you don't believe it, I'm going to stop being kind to you? Because you don't trust me, I'm going to stop being kind to you? Not if I love you. Because I do. I can't stop loving you. If I can't stop loving you, I never loved you. So I'm looking forward to loving somebody. I look forward to really loving somebody. I hope it's you. So what would you have me do? What is your will for me? Okay, any thoughts? Any sharing? Yes, my brother!
My opinion, everybody's opinion, is just another event. All events are neutral, they have no innate value. So anybody's opinion, including mine, has only the value that I or anyone else gives it.
Right. That's how people get elected. Is that a bunch of people give what they're saying meaning to them, and then they vote for them.
Well, you know, that reminds me of a quote that I read today. I thought, in my sinful way, I really got it.
Could you speak up a little bit? Just a little bit.
The quote was, why bother trying to discover the truth when it's so easily created?
Yes, why? I would try to discover the truth because it's already created, but for some reason I don't know where to see it. That's where I would try to discover it.
The context was the political arena.
Mm-hmm. 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 Thank you.
Mm. All right, so if somebody pushes my button and I get triggered, and that is a reflection of what I don't love in myself, which, in other words, could be the fear that I have in myself. So I want to look at the fear for it to come up, to be healed. So I'm like, okay, so once I go through this process and I realize and I acknowledge that it's my trigger, it's my fear, and it's my healing. Like with Chris, too. Like, what do we do with it when we're trying to transform it at that point?
Well, it's two things. One thing you could do is see the fear itself as a call or a request for the love that's required. Because it's love that's required. Right. So my fear is my call. for love.
I did that. Yeah, I'm like, okay, that's my call for love. Okay.
Now, the other thing is you can't keep a pattern that you recognize.
Okay.
Okay. So even if right now you're not able to stop the pattern, you know you're going to ultimately stop the pattern because you're recognizing you're the one that's making it.
Okay.
And so one day you're going to go, oh, this thing I'm doing to myself, I'll stop.
Okay.
It's really that deep. I mean, it's really that simple. It's like, but not until you really get that it's you are the one that's making the pattern. So it's all, and I've used this analogy before, but it's a really good one, and I'll use it forever. Which is, it's analogous to unplugging a fan and then watching the blade still go around, even though you've unplugged the fan, until the blade gradually spins down and stops.
Uh-huh. So it's a natural evolution that's happening, and I'm in it right now.
You're in it. You've already pulled the plug when you start to take responsibility for your experience. Okay, so that was the effect. Effectively, that was pulling the plug. All right. What you're getting confused about is what I call the after image, which is the image of the blade still moving because they had momentum. Your ego had momentum. You pulled the plug on your ego, so you got to let, you know, like when people run a race, right? They don't go across the finish line and go, skate! Right? They always have to boop, 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 boop. And you're crucifying yourselves for powering down. Because you didn't immediately see the blade go, boop! Right? So you're still downing on yourself, and you're still criticizing yourself because your blade is still going around and round and round. Oh, and what you're doing is you're sticking your finger in the blade. You know, that's you judging yourself for still having the blade moving.
Uh-huh.
Is you sticking your finger in the blade, and so you hurt yourself because you're not gentle with yourself enough.
Wow.
You're too hard on yourselves. Give you a break. Do something meaningless. Okay.
Thank you.
You get to the point that the thoughtless ideas of the world are vacation. Because they're so mindless that you can relax with it. Because none of them are worth the slightest thought.
Give me alternative facts.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, how can something upset me that's just being endlessly entertaining to me out of its utter ridiculousness? Could I hear anything else more ridiculous than I'm not loved, and I'm not valuable, and I'm a victim of everything? Yes.
This is sort of related to what Susan said, but I was thinking also there's another aspect to it of it. I was thinking about this when you were talking about our process of, like, when we're triggered by somebody and that, how that indicates that we've got something that we need to dig up and deal with, and that our desire to analyze or judge someone is part of that process that we need to let go of. But I was feeling like what you just sort of finished up with before you opened us up for comments was, like, another step along that the way of the progress. As there's also an aspect to when somebody triggers us and we feel afraid, it's what you were just talking about as far as, like, we're also gaining awareness of, like, the more that we learn, the more we're able to recognize when somebody is unaware and ask ourselves, is this what I want, or do I want to run the other way? And so sometimes that feeling of being triggered is also progress to just, like, the discernment and recognizing, yeah, absolutely. Like, I don't want to be involved with this.
That's right. That's right. There's a statement in the Course in Miracles that I love. It says, recognize misery and go the other way. And I think that is just so simple and direct. You know, I'm walking along the road hiking. A bear comes in front of me. Recognize misery, go the other way. I don't stop and have a conversation with the bear, analyze the bear, ask why did the bear come there. Ask what, you know, it's like I'm not going to stop and analyze. I'm going to recognize the danger, recognize the misery, and I'm just going to go the other way. And sometimes people feel like if they don't deal with it, then there's somehow another being weak. But it could be as simple as I recognize that if I connect up with you in a relationship, I'm going to be miserable based on the values I have and the perception I have of you. So if I can't change my perception of you, I best not deal with you right now. Because even if you're the nicest person in the world, I'm going to give myself misery through you. So I need to get my perception corrected first, if at all possible. Your ego is going to say, dive in there anyway. And all of you have done that enough to know exactly what that experience produces. I can't stand being in relationships now that I'm constantly processing with somebody. Why am I having to explain myself to somebody I love? That means you're trying to decide whether or not you're going to love me or not. And I'm trying to sit up here with you and decide whether or not I'm going to love you or not. Which means me seeing you in a loving way is up for grabs. But what if I've already decided to see you in a loving way, no matter what, and instead I'm asking, how can I help this person get beyond any perception of pain? What if that's what I'm trying to work out with you as your partner? What can I do to be a way for you to get out of the pain? Because me loving you or not is not the issue. I don't care what you've done. I just know you are suffering, and I don't want you to. So you can explain what you did last night to me or not. That's up to you. Because I'm not. Because whether I'm going to love you or not is not up for question. So therefore, I don't care what you did. Because I'm not going to withdraw my love from you, no matter what you did. That's a love so far beyond anything I've ever witnessed in the human body that it sounds ridiculous to a part of me to even say it, and my mind immediately goes to, what if they take advantage of me? That's the first place the ego man goes. What if they take advantage of me? What if they mistreating me?
Yeah.
No, you're mistreating you, and then they're reflecting your self-mistreatment back to you. So you can take a look at what needs to be loved in you. You don't have to believe this. You don't have to accept this. You don't have to welcome it. So it's going to be hard to believe and quite startling. But if you use this, you'll see it works.
Earl, I just really wanted to thank you for what you said about the fan and the blades and all that.
One picture is worth a thousand words sometimes, bro.
With me yesterday, perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I know I got some stuff in me that needs to be healed.
Me too.
And I don't mind being in a relationship with somebody as long as we both have the goal of being in the presence of love, and we know we don't know how to do that, and so therefore we're going to be compassionate and patient with each other, and we're both going to take responsibility for our feelings in the relationship and not hold the other one responsible for our happiness. I will be with you to the end of time. But any other way, I ain't getting on that plane. They ain't getting on that train because I already know where it's headed. To hell. I'm not getting on the hell train no more. I don't care how many of my friends still get on the hell train. You know, how many of my relatives still get on the hell train and don't take the time to learn how to tell when they're in the presence of somebody who loves them and somebody who doesn't. Fine. I know. So I'm going to keep saying no.
Mm-hmm.
No.
No.
No. And what I've discovered is it doesn't mean there's going to be any lack of love in your life. It doesn't mean you're not going to have a social life. It doesn't mean somebody's not going to ask you out. It doesn't mean you're not going to make love. It doesn't mean you're not going to travel. That's the other big lie that people tell themselves when they think they don't have one special person. That they're not going to have people that love them. That's a lie. You're not going to miss nothing except the guilt. The bargain. The person trying to get you to act out their script for their own personal pleasures, regardless of what you want, that's the only thing you'll be missing. And people who like to manipulate hate to hear somebody say the things I'm saying tonight.
Yeah.
I've made some illusion of enemies. just from some people listening to me. Because I said the main thing that people who limit people don't want to hear, which is you don't love somebody you're trying to limit. Mm-hmm. If when someone knows they're doing that because they feel insecure, so they're trying to control somebody, they don't want to hear that. Because they'll lose their control over the other person. If I'm not afraid of losing you, you can threaten me all night with leaving. It's not going to upset me. Go. Stay. Go. If you want to go. Stay. If you want to stay. But don't want to go and then stay. Because that's just cruel.
Or want to stay and then go.
Right. When I'm talking to somebody and they're having a hard time leaving in a relationship and they're all upset about it and they're freaking out because they think they need to leave but they can't leave. And then I say, well, stay. Because you don't want to go. You'll know when it's time. When it was time for my marriage to end, I didn't care about whether she had the house, the car, my bank account, or nothing. When you are done, you are done. And you don't be trying to hang on to material things that you know can be replaced at any time. If you hang on to those things and you're letting those things matter, it's because you're not ready to leave the relationship. So it keeps y'all in communication, haggling with each other. Because you still want to be in each other's presence, even if it's as special hate. Y'all know what I'm saying. I tell my male friends, I say, man, you know, your girlfriend keep giving you another chance. They keep giving you another chance. You keep doing this stuff, and they keep giving you another chance. I say, sooner or later, she's going to threshold. What does that mean? She's going to be done. And when a woman is done, she's done. And you're going to beg, and you're going to cry, and you're going to say, give me another chance, I'll do it, because you took it for granted that she was going to always give you another chance. Mm-hmm. And you weren't paying attention. And now she's done. So what's the lesson? Don't do that again. That's the only afterward message of any lesson. Don't do that again. You're not bad. You're not guilty. You're not horrible. Just don't do that again. So what was the crime? Usually the crime is always non-appreciation. It's some form of you all are not appreciating each other, and you're not appreciating each other's good efforts. You're focusing on what's missing and never acknowledging what you have. That's what egos do. That's what unawake people do. They can't see anything but lack in some form. So do you want to spend the rest of your life trying to fill a hole in a person that can only be filled by themselves and God? It's like if you could imagine a hole going through the center of the earth from the top to the bottom. So if you drop something at the top, it went all the way through the earth and came out the bottom into the universe. That's what it's like trying to love somebody that don't love themselves. Every bit of love you give them, it goes into vast emptiness. They're never filled. You can never do enough because you can't complete them. Never forget, the only one that doesn't have a relationship is the person that doesn't want one. And the person that has a relationship is a person who wants one. Those are only two types of people. There's no such thing as a person who wants a relationship and can't have one. For some reason, I don't want a relationship, so therefore, I don't have one, So I would like to have one. I've changed my mind. I'm ready to have one. And I can tell the sincerity of my request by the actual manifestation and offering of the relationship showing up. Cause and effect are one. Cause and effect happen at the same time.
Would a good question be, what would it take for me to truly want a relationship?
That would be the first thing I would do, would be to ask for a sincere desire, just like what you're saying. Because obviously, I think I'm asking for something I'm not really asking for.
Right. Or that I don't genuinely want.
Or that I don't really genuinely want. But I empower myself when I admit that to myself.
Yeah.
That I'm not being deprived. It's just something I'm afraid of right now. Or it's just not the right time yet.
Mm-hmm.
Before I die, I'm going to experience being loved 100% exactly as I am. That's my goal. And I'm willing to tell you how I'm going to accomplish that. By me learning how to accept myself exactly as I am. So I'm not actually looking for another person to do it. I'm going to do it. And when I do it, I'm going to attract people who do it with me and toward me. I'm going to do it the easy way. It's much easier for me to accept me than to get you to accept me. Especially if you got a fantasy that you want me to fulfill. Because you're going to want me to fulfill your fantasy. And if what I want to do doesn't fulfill your fantasy, the temptation would be not to accept me until I do. So I'll just leave you out. And I'll accept me. Does that make sense to everybody? I keep asking that because I don't want to lose everybody. Because what the hell is he talking about? Let me go home. It's crazy. I want to know if you're with me. Do you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. I need feedback.
So you were talking about the people who can never get enough love or like a bottomless pit. What if you're that person that has a part of that is you, and you're trying to study the truth and trying to get it, but then you still have that part of you.
In other words, the fan blade is still going around. That's all you're saying. Even though I want this and I'm still like, well, you're still confusing the fan blade going around with you not having unplugged the fan. So you got to consciously remember that you've unplugged the fan. Because see, you can't go by your eyes because your eyes still see the blade going around. So that's why knowledge is beyond perception. Knowledge is beyond perception because you can know something without necessarily physically seeing it. Do you follow the difference in that? Knowledge is beyond perception. That's what makes it so powerful. It's to know I have unplugged the fan, and because I still see the blades of the past going around, it doesn't mean I haven't unplugged the fan. I have knowledge. And it's beyond what I'm seeing, because it looks like the fan blade is still going around. And that's what you got to understand, Chris. You still having your patterns, or still seeing some of your old behavior still happening. It's just the after image of the fan that you've unplugged. How do you know you've unplugged it? Because you are taking more and more responsibility for your experience. That's it's as simple as that. A person who is not ready for their pattern to end is the person who doesn't see themselves as responsible for it. So you show me the person who's taking no responsibility for their experience, and you're showing me the person that still wants to keep their pattern going.
Thanks.
So now you know where in your own life that you're keeping your patterns going. It's in whatever area of your life that you're acting like you're the victim of somebody else. That's where your pattern still is alive and well. If you think your financial situation has anything to do with being a woman, being black, being white, you know, your childhood, any of that, then you still want to keep your pattern going. And you're not recognizing that you have the power to change all of that right now.
Yeah.
Course in Miracles says people are not interested in answers that you give them that doesn't have to do with somebody else being the one that's got to handle it. Okay? That's why none of us tend to get excited. Because the answer you're going to like the most would be the one where I said everything could change for you without you having to do anything. And then somebody else is going to do it for you. And the Course in Miracles even promises that. It says, it's possible for you to be corrected in an instant, but it requires a willingness that you just don't have yet. And as soon as you're willing, you could have every problem you think you have corrected, he says, in an instant. Now, even if you don't believe that, it would make you feel good just to say it to yourself. And remember what Spirit told us earlier? Your belief in what I just said has nothing to do with the truth of it. That's true. All your problems could be solved, Earl, if you really worked on your relationship with God, your Creator, that which created you, as your primary focus. Mm-hmm. That's the truth, whether you believe it or not. But no, you want to do it the hard way.
That's boring.
You want to do it all on your own, all by yourself, using your wisdom, don't you? Yeah. That's why you struggle. Because you want to be autonomous and self-sufficient, separate from your source. Well, how can I tell if I'm really still trying to handle everything myself? Okay, I'm glad you asked. Because you have fear. And fear always means you're trusting in your own strength, separate from your Creator's. See how you can't hide when you really start hearing this stuff? You can't hide. You can't sit up and tell me you're full of fear and you believe in God. You can tell me that, but I won't believe you believe. That doesn't mean you're not connected to God. That doesn't mean you are not completely connected to Source. So I'm not saying that. I'm saying you don't know it. Right. Or you wouldn't be afraid about everything.
What about someone who says that they don't believe in God and they don't have any fear?
That they lie.
I just wanted to hear.
Just it's a big bunch of crap. You know people don't say stuff that's true. Especially men, when as a man, you've been taught to never say you're afraid. That's the last thing you're supposed to ever say. You are totally a pussy if you say you're afraid. If you're a man, I could be out with a date and I could come up on a Denver Bronco and I'm supposed to act like I'm not afraid if he's angry with me. As a man, you don't say you're afraid. That's what's kind of sad to me, to watch younger men nowadays, when they're just being even more made to believe that you don't show any signs of softness or feeling or anything. You know. But just because you tell me something, that don't mean I believe it. You know what I'm saying? Like you were saying, suppose a person tell you that they don't really not afraid. Okay, they said it. But they're, you know, they're upset, but they don't have no fear. They are never happy, but they don't have any fear. They love everybody, but nobody loves them. Mm-hmm. You can't love everybody and nobody loves you. And you can't really want companionship and be alone. And you can't really want wealth and be broke. You can't really want eternal life and then think you're a body that dies after a certain number of years. It's easy to tell who knows the truth and who doesn't. Because all you have to do is listen. Yeah, what be saying there, darling?
They are totally loving this conversation online. Perfect conversation for Valentine's Day, by the way. But two that I really want to pull out. Dharma Soul has started a series of statements that basically she said, yes, I don't want a relationship. I am the relationship. I am 100% my best lover.
All right. Mm-hmm. And you are you're a person who's going to have a lot of lovers if you want them. See, I know she's going to have lovers. I know she's going to have dates if she wants them, and trips if she wants them. Why? Because she doesn't need it. She's whole, so her reality reflects her own wholeness back to her. It's the person who thinks they're not whole who's always trying to get relationships that elude them. D.
Yeah.
What's the other one
suggest? And then Karen says, the other person doesn't push your buttons. You're pushing your own buttons.
That's true, too. But I would say you're pushing your own buttons through the other person.
Mm-hmm.
Because let's face it, it looks like other people push our buttons more than we push our buttons, if we'll be honest with ourselves. Mm-hmm. It looks like I'm much more upset about you not doing what I want you to do than I am about me not doing what I want you to do. I'm really looking for you to do it for me. So she's right. She's right. I'm pushing my own buttons through everybody. Or I'm thrilling myself through everybody. I'm loving myself through everybody. I'm having a great time through everybody. Also, all right. Father, mother, what would you have me do? What is your will for me? Let's acknowledge us. Can we do that? I would love to ask you to acknowledge yourself the way you'd like to be acknowledged. Yeah, I'm willing to give it to me the way I'd like to have it. Give it to you the way you'd like to have it. Yeah, that's cool. All right, we'll do a quick little ending thing right after we do the financial expression of appreciation. I appreciate you sharing. I am glad that I do this in the world is the way that I live in the world. And I want to thank you for seeing value in what I do. Those of you that are watching online, that you also see value and you want to be financially supportive of this teaching ministry, you can go to my website, earlpurdy.com. I really thank you. Appreciate you. Those of you who would like to have personal counseling sessions with me where I work with you to get past any blocks that you know you're ready to let go of, I do what I call clarity sessions. Go to my website. It explains everything that I offer. And I also use my knowledge of astrology and numerology, which started my whole spiritual path. And for people who are open to it, then I'll also let that be a way of spirit communicating too. And I'm also available for mentoring if you're ready to get past the blocks to study and going ahead and seeing the quickest, easiest way of working on this. So thank you for watching. Thank you for being here at the live stream of the Way of Mastery every Tuesday at 7 p.m. of Mountain Standard Time. And then the Course in Miracles at 1 o'clock p.m. Mountain Standard Time on Sunday. And then I do another class called A Course of Love, live streamed on Facebook on Thursdays at 7 p.m. And it's hardcore, too. It's to the heart what the Course in Miracles is to the mind. One thing you heard tonight that you would like to remember, anybody?
The fan blade.
The fan blade. Don't be fooled by the blade that's still going around of your past patterns. Thank you. Don't be fooled by the fan blade.
My only purpose is to be the presence of love.
My only true purpose is to be the presence of love. I might think it's something else, but ultimately, that's what I'm really on the planet for. Is to be the presence of love. And that's the same as saying to be the presence of freedom. Freedom and love are the same thing.
Knowing love is, in order to know love, I have to be love.
In order to know love, I have to be love. Mm-hmm. I have to be what I want to have. Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
Even as I'm fully awake, I'll still recognize that I'm the created.
Yeah, even if I'm fully awake, I'll still remember I didn't create myself. I'm the created. So I do have a source I can call on for guidance.
To be gentle with myself and to recognize that I am making progress, that I am moving forward.
Be gentle with yourself and recognize you are making progress, you are moving forward. That's awesome.
When I get triggered, it's something in me that needs to be loved.
When you get triggered, there's something in you that's requiring love. Great. Great. Anybody online say anything, CJ?
Everyone's saying thank you, thank you, thank you. Several of the comments are kind of in the same line, and it's that element of recognizing that I have to be the love first.
Exactly. Like Marie is saying, give what you want to receive. Jerry is saying, I put the buttons in place to be pushed. And so I can look at what I need to correct for love to flow. Rita says, I am in deep gratitude for this whole experience. I love you. Thank you. Mm. Oh, wow. Okay. I'm going to finish this with the two questions to take with us. Okay, so just breathe and take a couple of minutes. We're going to be out of here in a minute. Because right now you just need to rest your little brains. Just rest your little minds on Valentine's. Yes. Here we go. So you ask yourself, Creator, what would you have me do? 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 Creator, what is your will for me?
Share your time. Share your love. Share your mind.
Love, what would you have me do? 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 God, what would you have me do? God, what would you have me do? God, what would you have me do? That what you would have me do? What else? Tell me one more time, God. Tell me, God.
Share
my time.
Share
my love. Share my heart. What is your will for me? What is your will for me? What is your will for me, God? What is your will for me, love? What is your will for me, God? What is your will for me, love? What is your will for me, love? What is your will for me, God? What is your will for me, God? What? My companions, happy Valentine's Day. And hugs are available after the class. And may the course
be with you.
I love you. Thanks for coming out. Thanks for coming out. Come on. I know. It's for you. I know. Take some minutes to get it okay to do it for you. I love y'all. Y'all so. I love you. And you're so cool. Yikes.